All right, how are we doing today, guys? All right. Awesome. Welcome back. Welcome back to the National Conservative Student Conference. You guys might be tired. You guys might be low energy. But I can tell you right now that our next speaker is going to pump you up. I have the pleasure to introduce to you today one of the finest and most accomplished professors in the United States today, Dr. Burt Folsom, Jr. Dr. Folsom is the now retired professor of history at Hillsdale College, where he has been teaching for over 20 years. His lectures have slayed dragons with their energy, enthusiasm, and life-changing potential. I have never met a man so devoted to taking on so many sacred cows. Robert Barons, Reconstruction, Wilson, FDR, American exceptionalism with such irreverent savagery as he does and he will do today. He is the author of several books on American history, including New Deal or Raw Deal, How FDR's Economic Legacy Has Damaged America, where he systematically deconstructs the leftist academic consensus on FDR's New Deal policy. His prolific output of work includes articles written in the Wall Street Journal and National Review. His thoughtful commentary on history and politics has been essential reading for any budding young conservative seeking a lucid counterpoint to his or her liberal textbook. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm honored to introduce to you today Dr. Burt Folsom.
Thanks. Great. Hey. Boy, I think I see. How many Hillsdale students are here? Yay. Several. Good. Where I teach. Good to be here. And to be addressing you on history. Yeah, you get your history lesson early. I mean, it's August. School starts in August. This is the beginning of your history lesson for August. I want to talk a little bit and ask a question that you don't get asked very often by your history professors or, you know, your books and all of this. And that is, how did America become the dominant economic power in the world? Now, sometimes you get people say, well, we got good immigrants or we had good natural resources. Well, we got the immigrants because we had a lot of things going for us and they came where the action was. Natural resources, other nations have comparable resources. You look, what is it that made America great? You have two kind of schools of thought that come down on that. And one of them says that you get great, at least the recipe, is by having entrepreneurs in a relatively free market produce products that become competitive, create jobs, innovation, and the economic greatness comes from that. And the founders of our country were aligning with that idea. The other view, more common, is the idea that, hey, you need to have government start something. They have to be involved. They have to decide where the money should go. They have to decide what industry should be involved. Maybe even picking the people to help run the industry. And that through that central direction, a nation can grow and prosper. Now, in this country, we have had a lot of people who said, hey, I think we ought to go the entrepreneur route. But we've had a lot of people who say, hey, I think the government route is pretty good too. In fact, former Vice President Biden made the statement. He said, every single great idea in America in the 1800s, the 1900s, and the 2000s, every single great idea of the 1800s, 1900s, and 2000 has been marked and created by government vision and government incentive. And he was specifically, when people said, well, can you think of specifics? It was transportation in the 1800s was where he started. And that was where a lot of the action was in the United States. We were still a second-rate power. I want to start with steamships. Biden specifically mentioned railroads. I want to go to them too. But let's start with the steamships. Transportation is important because with transportation you can get goods quickly back and forth to different markets. You look at steamships. Before we had the steamship, we had the sailing ships. Columbus, it took him 2 to 3 months to get over here. 2 to 3 months. 2 to 3 months to go back. Well, I mean, imagine, we just see how gas prices and everything can change in a short period of time. How do you know what to buy, what to pay for? Then by the time you get over here, it's a different price. You have to pay for a crew all the way over here. The costs of doing business are huge. Steamships allow you to plow through the water and not only quicker, but without being dependent upon wind power. You can go much faster. Instead of being 3 months, 2 to 3 months, you could do it in under 2 weeks. And this development of the 1800s, 1840s, 1850s, was so phenomenal that naturally it raised the question, what are we going to do? I mean, you take it, it's August. On August 3rd, today, you could, this was phenomenal, people of the 1850s, but you could have somebody leave New York City port with a load of goods, take them over to England, drop them off in Liverpool, come back, and it would still be August. You know, wow, the savings you have on just paying a crew, on insurance, on being able to get more voyages back and forth, the costs go down, international traffic becomes possible, and you naturally had people say, should we have the entrepreneurs do this or should we have government do it? We had congressional hearings on this. One of the ones who was testifying was a shipper by the name of Edward Collins. And Collins came in and they asked him, do you think it's possible that we should have, that entrepreneurs can do this, or should we think of having the government try to set some business or establish some business or help subsidize some business? And Collins said, I definitely think that this needs to be done through a subsidy. I don't think it can be done without government help. And they said, you really think that? And he said, yes, in fact, I volunteer to receive the subsidy. I, Edward Collins, am going to receive that subsidy. And they said, well, what do you mean? And he said, look, I've got an idea. Give me, this is back in the 1850s, give me, it, by the way, we had balanced budgets back then. We didn't even have any deficit. We had a couple of years where we had surplus. I mean, the whole debt, there was no debt, there was just surplus. And one of the big issues under President Jackson was, what do we do with all this leftover money at the end of the year? And so, you know, a lot of people, well, Collins was saying, I know what we can do, give a subsidy to me to go do a steamship business. And he said, it was going to be $385,000, that would be many millions of dollars today, $385,000 a year. And I will do steamship traffic back and forth from England. You know, I'll get a two-week service. I'll start on Monday, get to Liverpool, and then I'll have another ship leave on Monday. And I'll have four ships, and I'll have them regular Monday service back and forth with the two ships going. Now, with that process, they said, gee, $385,000. Maybe we ought to consider this. He said, oh, one more thing. I'll need an extra $3 million to build me the ships. So I need the ships, and then I need $385,000. He says, one good thing, maybe I won't need a subsidy after I get going. In other words, once I get going, I'll be efficient, the subsidy will work, and then we will flourish, and we won't need it anymore. Congress deliberated on this very carefully, 1847, 1848, and they voted to give Collins the subsidy. In other words, we were saying, Biden's quote, every major idea is marked by government vision and government incentive. That's the way you have to develop economically. We were buying into what Biden was going to talk about 150 years later. And we did give Mr. Collins a subsidy. He came out. He got the ships built. He was going with his service over to Liverpool and then back to the United States and was going back and forth with his steamships. At the end of a year, he came before Congress. They're all kind of, you know, giving him high fives. You know, that's great. You did your service and all of that. And he said, I did one thing, though. I got a late start. It took me a while to build the ships. I ran into some debts. and I'm going to need a little increase next year. 400,000. The next year, he had problems with caulking in one of his ships. They had some leaks. It was out of commission for a while. He says, look, I had an unexpected circumstances beyond my control. I need $500,000 next year. Congress deliberated, voted him the $500,000. The next year, he had a sudden need. I resisted using the word urge. A sudden need for $600,000. So he came in and requested $600,000 to run this steamship service, keeping the United States in the competition. After this, a man named Cornelius Vanderbilt, who himself ran steamship business, was totally repelled by what he was seeing. And he said, I could do this cheaper than that. He said, made an offer before Congress. I don't know what Collins is going to ask for next year, but whatever he asks for, I'll do it for half price. Interesting, isn't it? Vanderbilt comes before Congress, says, half price, I will run the steamship service. Sure enough, Collins comes before Congress, $700,000 request. Now, I know we're in history and politics, but can we do math for just a minute here? Right. How much is Vanderbilt going to say he'll do it for if Collins says $700,000? $350,000. Good, good. A plus in math today. So now this is interesting, isn't it? Because Congress now has a choice. We can either do steamship service with Vanderbilt for $350,000. $350,000, or we can do the steamship service with Collins for $700,000, and he's delivering passengers and mail and freight and all of this. So a lot of this is online. And so Vanderbilt says, I'll do it for half price. And I have a question for you. How many of you think Vanderbilt, with his offer of half price, how many think Congress accepted the offer to have Mr. Vanderbilt do the steamship service at half price? One, two, not too many here. Anybody else? Oh, three, four, five, six. How many think, no, they didn't do it? They turned him down. Look at that. I can tell you people have been at a YAF conference for 4 days. I mean, the brain cells are moving there. Why not? Somebody help me. Why not? Yes?
If it fails,
in other words, you're saying Vanderbilt may fail.
Exactly.
You know what? You it's as though you read the congressional record. In my research for my book, The Myth of the Robber Barons, I was researching this, and that really is what was said in the congressional record. In other words, what I'm telling you here, the majority of you who said that they turned Vanderbilt down and accepted Collins at a double price, in effect, $700,000, the majority is correct. For the very reason you say. They said, how do we know Vanderbilt can do it? Collins, we know Collins can do it. He's done the service. You give it to Vanderbilt, you don't know if he can do it. Collins is our government guy. We don't know if Vanderbilt can do it. And so they turned him down. Collins was quite pleased. You know, he was happy going into D.C., you know, coming in there. He was operating most of his business out of New York, but of course, he was there for the vote in D.C. He goes back to New York. He's all excited. Goes into New York port, and he had a most unpleasant discovery. There in the harbor next to his ship was another ship. And it didn't take much imagination to figure out what was happening. The other ship was named the Vanderbilt. And when he inquired more deeply into what Vanderbilt's ship was in there doing next to his ship, it was filling up with passengers at a discounted price, Collins was charging $200 per passenger. Vanderbilt, and then cut it back a little bit to 150. Vanderbilt was cutting it down to 50 and had loads of passengers and no subsidy. And he was crusty, and he said, nobody tells me I can't do this business. I'm going to do it with no subsidy. So now we have Vanderbilt with no subsidy and discount prices filling his ship up, and Collins is watching this happen. Vanderbilt then had a further insult to Collins. He just ripped out of New York Harbor and was passing Collins. You know, you see, those people on the harbor watching could see Vanderbilt disappearing into the east, and Collins was still visible, you know, chugging along his ship. And Vanderbilt broke the record for the fastest time overseas. He did it in less than 11 days and from New York to Liverpool. One thing Vanderbilt discovered, though, it was expensive to go fast. It was like driving a car fast, you know, fuel expenses. Are we more fuel efficient going, what? Are we more fuel efficient going 90 miles an hour or 50? Yeah, it's more fun to go 90, except on 395 here in Washington, D.C., you can't even go 5 sometimes. And it's not fuel efficient that way either. But Vanderbilt was discovering that it was very fuel efficient to go slower. So he tended to be a little bit slower than Collins in the future. He would, to save fuel, he didn't have the government paying for his fuel. You know, you're putting the coal in the burners and the getting the going. You can't do that if you don't have a subsidy. Collins has a subsidy. At the end of 1 year, though, Vanderbilt was giving discounted prices. He discovered something which economists call economies of scale, and that is with ships. He said, Collins will typically get a couple hundred people on his ship. Sometimes he can get 300 or 400, but usually it's not that many. He said, with my discounted prices, plus I'm going to make some money on food. See, selling food to the passengers. He even helped invent the potato chip. They were called Saratoga chips back then. You know, Vanderbilt was trying to, let's give them food. They like. Michelle Obama would not have approved of his voyages. And he ended up going, though, with the food and with the $50 fares. He even got it down to $30 at one point. Now, I mean to say these people were packed on his ships. But he said, if I get 600 people, maybe even 650 on my ship, then I can make, if I make $50 on those 650, that's better than if I'd had 100 and I was making $100 or 120 per passenger. Plus, I'm making money on the food for all the passengers that I have on the ship. So Vanderbilt was trying to work his way through this with a free enterprise idea, and he said, I think I can make a go of it. At the end of 1 year, Vanderbilt was making a profit. Collins lost money. In fact, the next year, everybody thought, well, I wonder, boy, Collins better come in here and apologize to us. Collins came in and said, not only am I not apologizing, I'm making a request next year for $858,000. And they said, why this huge increase to $858,000? He said, because I'm losing business to Vanderbilt. I have fewer people on my ships because they're going over and doing Vanderbilt, so I need a subsidy even larger to keep me in business. Congress has a choice. They can accept Collins's offer to do $858,000 the next year, or they can turn it down. Go with perhaps Vanderbilt with no subsidy at all. And I have a question for you. How many of you think Congress accepted Collins' offer to do $858,000. Boy, a lot. A lot of people. How many think, no, they're not going to do that. No, no, they didn't accept it. Hand, yes. Many. Yeah, you. Of course, you voted that way the first time, too. That was, yeah, now, who else? What about over here? No, a bunch of no's here. No, they're not going to do that, are they? No. let me see those again. I have to see who's in the majority. How many think they did? They gave him the subsidy. Did not give him the subsidy. Okay. In this case, the majority thinks they gave him the subsidy. Idealistic young students, and you think they gave him the subsidy. In this case, the majority is correct. They gave it to him. They gave it to him. $858,000. And so Collins, he had the old sigh of relief. And he had won the battle. And Vanderbilt had lost. And Collins was excited to be going. And they came into New York Harbor again. And Vanderbilt was saying, when they said, well, now, why should we give you the subsidy? One of the reasons he was saying that I have the fastest service. Vanderbilt is slow. I'm fast. And so Vanderbilt decided to have a little bit of fun. And he came out of New York Harbor again, just zipping down the line. And Collins had promised that he was the quickest. So Collins would really go fast to catch up with Vanderbilt. Vanderbilt had given instructions to his steamship captain, let them pass you and then slow down, but he'll always think you're on his tail and they'll waste all that fuel. And so Collins was going ripping down there. Collins was going very fast. Collins was going too fast. How many of you have seen one of the versions of the movie The Titanic? Right. That was not the first ship to whack into an iceberg. Collins has one of the first, killing 454 people. Whack. And then what was worse, shortly after that, he had a ship take off from Liverpool, England, and come over here, and nobody found it. I mean, it must have hit an iceberg or something. It was vanished. And Collins is sitting there, oh my gosh, I'm down to two ships. And Collins had to make an immediate request to Congress. $1 million to build a ship to keep me in the competition with Vanderbilt. And I have a question for you. How many of you think that Congress, upon hearing Collins' request for a $1 million to build a ship, said, yes, Mr. Collins, of course, we'll build you a ship? This is the most cynical group of young people I think I've ever. Look at that. Look at those hands. Some of them just shot. Did you see that? They're just whoop. In fact, a couple of them were up before I even asked the question. Let me see those hands again. How many? Oh, gosh, a lot. How many think, no! Draw the line here. No! 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 Oh, there you go. I was looking to see if you were still up. Yep. Good. Yes! However, you're in a minority. You're in a minority. The majority thinks they gave him the $1 million to build the ship. And in this case, the majority is right. You're right. They did it. They built him the ship. Collins was so excited, I get a new ship. And he built it so quickly to get back in the competition. They only built him one because he wanted to build two. And they said, well, the other one that disappeared may reappear, so we're only going to build one. People said the only thing Collins really makes disappear is government money. And so Collins was so happy that he had his little ship and he built it quickly to get back in the race. He built it too quickly. In reading about what happened next, I tried to read the most thorough naval accounts that I could. And I hope you don't mind, I'm going to use naval terminology here to describe the problem of the ship. The problem with the ship was it took water. In other words, it was caulked very poorly because it was so quickly built, and it was leaking. And because it was leaking, the passengers in the middle of the ocean trying to get to England were becoming extremely practiced in this motion. Maybe that's the first government bailout. You're all clapping. These people are already maybe drowning, and you're all clapping. Listen, this is one of those stories. You're thinking the last one sunk and killed 454. This one, they made it. They made it to land. And I was reading an account of it. I said, the passengers were quite pleased when land was in sight. Yeah, they were pleased, and then land comes in. Oh, it's like land. There it is. Yeah, they're crawling off the ship. They're soggy pants and everything. They're getting off. Yeah, we're happy. Yeah. They got off. And Collins, you know, nobody died on my ship. You know, it's like, you know, they may have had T-shirts. I was on a Collins ship and lived to tell. I know, they had T-shirts and everything. And Collins thought, this is great. Nobody died, everybody. The problem was the next Monday when the ship was coming back. It had zero passengers. And Collins said, what am I going to do with my ship that I built that cost $1 million? And he said, nobody wants to buy it. And he put it up for auction. And, you know, what do you bid on a leaky ship? He said, well, okay, I know I'm not going to get $1 million, but I'll get something. And he did get something. He got an offer, which was accepted, the high bid in the auction, gave Mr. Collins a loss. You understand he'll have to take a loss. The loss was $990,000. In other words, $10,000 was what the ship sold for. I read one account and said, oh, that's ridiculous. And I read another one that said, would you pay $10,000 even for a leaky ship? And that was about what it was worth. Now, this puts Collins on the spot. He's back down another ship, and he came before Congress. Ladies and gentlemen, he said, I come before you to request a subsidy to keep me in the competition. Not $1 million, as I did last time, but $990,000. Here is $10,000 right down. $990,000 is what I request to keep me in business against this Vanderbilt, this greedy, cutthroat competitor. And I have a question for you. How many of you think that when Collins requested another ship, $990,000, that Congress gave him the money? I'm looking to see. No, your hand is not up. Okay. Okay, a lot. How many over here? Oh, a lot. How many think, no. A majority of you thinks they gave him the money. And in this case, the majority. Is wrong! Let's hear it for Congress! Hear it for Congress! Woo-hoo! Congress! 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 Yay! Woo-hoo-hoo! Congress! Congress, they did it! They did it! I heard somebody say, Congress hasn't done anything, hasn't ever made it a good decision. False! They cut him off! And, you know, in writing about this, perhaps it was cruel, but I decided in my chapter on Vanderbilt, in Myth of the Robber Barons, and we're going to get you this book this afternoon. Some of the congressmen, see if you can detect displeasure with Collins. Senator Judah Benjamin of Louisiana said, I believe the Collins line has been most miserably managed. Senator Robert Hunter of Virginia went further. The whole system was wrong. It should have been left like any other trade to competition. Senator Thompson, John Thompson of Kentucky, said this. Give neither this line nor any other line a subsidy. Let the Collins line die. Whew. No more subsidies for Collins. Not only they didn't build him a ship, they wouldn't give him his annual subsidy. He was gone. He was competing head-to-head with Vanderbilt, and he went bankrupt in 6 months. And I know some of you think, well, does that leave Vanderbilt all alone? No, the British were still competing. They had the Cunard line, which still exists in this country. They had the Inman line. We had three steamship lines and others from other countries that were trying to get started. We still had competition. The rates were very low. We spent $11 million on steamship subsidies. Our national debt in 1860, after the steamship subsidies were over, was $60 million. In other words, 20% of our entire national debt was for steamship subsidies, and we had Vanderbilt around to do it in a free enterprise system all along. Now, I wish I could say after that, we learned our lesson. We never did that again, or anything even remotely like it. Well, we didn't for 2 years. And then we had the Transcontinental Railroad subsidies. We're going to build transcontinental lines across. We had railroads in the eastern part of the country, but we needed to go west, Omaha, out to California. So we thought, well, listen, we've learned a lesson here, a couple things. And I mean, Abraham Lincoln was involved in this. We've learned a lesson from Collins. We're not just going to give subsidies to one company. We're going to give subsidies to two companies and let them compete for subsidies. So you had the Central Pacific and the Union Pacific, and they were going to build, Central Pacific was going to start out in California, and that they were going to go east, and then the Union Pacific was going to go west, and then the two were going to meet. And it was going to be very expensive. As I mentioned, our whole national debt was $60 million. It was going to cost more than $60 million to build this railroad. When Vice President Biden made his statement that every good invention of the last 200 years, in other words, the 1800s, 1900s, 21st century, has required government vision and government incentive, he then was quite eloquent. He said, hey, the transcontinental railroads are a good example. And so the Union Pacific gets started, and we're going to give them subsidies by the mile to go out west. And so they start in Omaha, Nebraska. And Nebraska is very flat. I'm from Nebraska. It's very flat. It comes in, and you would find the railroad interesting. You would think, oh, I get it. They start here, and then they go west. Start here, then they go, right? The railroad took this shape. And, you know, why are you building a railroad like that? He says, because I'm being paid by the mile, by the government. And you get more money, more miles, more money, more miles. I gave this one time, I was talking about this to a group of adults. I mean, they were some of them seasoned professionals up there. And one fellow just raised his hand and said, I worked my whole life for the Union Pacific Railroad. I thought, well, this will be interesting. He says, and he looked around, he said, and I want you to know we're still trying to straighten that railroad out today. It just goes, yeah. You get paid by the mile. Well, now, then they come in, and it's, oh, Colorado, Rocky Mountains, hello. And what do we do about these things that are in the way? And they thought, well, to build a good railroad, you try to find the lowest grade possible. And, you know, if a mountain goes up, it goes down somewhere. I mean, there's bound to be somewhere you might be able to weave through. They thought, yeah, we can sit here and spend 2 years figuring it out. Meanwhile, the other railroad's getting all the subsidies. No. And so they said, let's just do it as well as we can. And I don't want to say it was just go up the mountain and down the mountain, but it was a terrible grade. And they couldn't get trains up. But they said, what? But we're being paid by the mile. See, so whether trains get up it or not isn't really our concern at the moment. Invent a better train, okay? And so they get over the mountain, and then they're going west in Colorado, and they're coming down, and they're running into the Central Pacific. The idea is they meet. Okay, they're going to meet, and they're coming in here, and they get about here, and all of a sudden, see, they'd invented dynamite. Had been invented, and both companies were using dynamite to not get hills and get a level terrain when possible. And Union Pacific could have written a book, the leaders, called Dynamite, Its Uses and Abuses. And one of the abuses we discovered when the railroads were getting close to each other, one of the abuses was sneaking in the middle of the night over to your competitor's railroad, blowing it up, and then the next morning saying, they don't get paid for that money, that mileage they built, because it doesn't exist anymore. Now, this is one of those, you know, in my teaching at Hillsdale College, I've never had a student miss this question. So I don't expect people to miss it. I hope you don't miss it here. What do you suppose the Central Pacific Railroad did in response to that behavior? Now, I have as an option, this is multiple choice. A, turn the other cheek. B, turn open a box of dynamite to be delivered and blow up their rails. How many want A? B. Now that one, the majority is definitely correct. They blew up the Union Pacific. So now both railroads are blowing the other one's track up. And Congress has to get involved saying, nobody blows up anybody's track anymore. Or nobody gets a subsidy. No. No. Yeah. Yeah, no. And so they then, okay. Now they're here the railroads come. They're coming. And they start paralleling each other, both of them saying, we get the money for the mile, the money for going this way. And both of them wanted money for the parallel miles. And they said, nobody's paralleling anybody and getting any money for it. You will meet at Promontory Point, Utah. You will. End. And so we met there. And a lot of your textbooks have had pictures of the meeting at the Promontory Point in Utah and the celebration that took place, the pounding in of the golden spike, even though the presidents of both railroads tried to whack in the golden spike and both missed. And so they got foremen to do it. It was done. Everybody got drunk. Temporarily, the golden spike got stolen. It was recovered. And that is the story of the Transcontinentals. A lot of people said, well, yeah, it had to be done that way because it's government vision and government incentive. It had to be done. James J. Hill said no. Said, you just did dumb railroad. That shouldn't be the Union Pacific, the dumb Pacific Railroad. Bad. He said, I'm going to build my own railroad and do it right with no government subsidy. And he built what is, many argue, the best built railroad from St. Paul, Minnesota to Seattle, Washington, all the way across the country with no subsidy. He developed the exports of the farm areas of the Dakotas, the copper in Montana, the apples and the trees out in Washington, and did a lumber industry going back and forth all the way across the country. He got through the Rocky Mountains by looking over the journals of Lewis and Clark to find out how they got across the country. And when he saw this Marias Pass that they talked about, he got a right-of-way passage, so he got a flat grade through. It was the best-built railroad, and it put the others out of business almost. The Union Pacific went broke. When the Panic of 1893 hit, the other transcontinentals could not compete. The only one that made a profit was the privately built Great Northern Railroad by James J. Hill, who didn't even have two eyes. He was a one-eyed immigrant. Came in there, he lost as a kid in a bow and arrow accident. And he said, I don't need two eyes to be able to see how to build a railroad better than this other one was built. He had this tremendously, it's part of the Burlington Central Railroad system today, tremendously built railroad. And when that happened, it was as though the light bulb went on in Congress. Wow, twice we tried steamships and transcontinentals, and they both flopped. Now, I don't know if we're ever going to catch England. We may be a second-rate power forever. Whether we make it or not, we're doing something different. We're not going to do it the way every other nation does it. We're built, you know, American exceptionalism, we're built on an idea. We're built a nation of ideas, the idea being that liberty can accomplish more than state direction and government intervention. We've gone away from our constitutional roots. And Congress said, we're not doing this anymore. We either rise or fall depending on our own merit and the entrepreneur's accomplishment, not on the basis of what we think might deserve a subsidy and give somebody aid to do it. And I'm here to report that the late 1800s was the most dramatic, perhaps prosperous period in American history. It was the time where we caught up with England and France and Germany. Those great powers. And you look at the inventions, like the typewriter. Yeah. You have inventions like electricity. And by the way, there's no government involvement in any of these inventions. Yeah, electricity. How about the automobile, Henry Ford? Not only was there no government, he was working for Edison. He was working for Edison, and in his spare time in a garage was making what he called a quadricycle. And he even put bicycle tires on his first car in the 1890s and had that car driving through the street, and he had the guy who owned, he was renting a house in a garage, and the guy was so upset because he couldn't get the quadricycle through the garage, so he took an axe and whacked it through, and he had one of those nosy neighbors who called up and said, there, that Henry Ford again is doing horrible things, and he's chopping your garage up. And the guy came running over, and he saw this engine, this quadricycle, this what we would call an automobile. And he says, oh, well, forget the garage. And he was the guy who held the lantern while the quadricycle went through the streets of Detroit. Yeah. Private. Edison. Private enterprise. No government involvement whatsoever. The telephone, Alexander Graham Bell. The telephone. Yeah, a tremendous invention. It never would have gotten going if the first call would have been a telemarketer, but it wasn't. And it was a very successful invention. Yeah, listen, telephone, typewriter, look at those, all within a short period of time in the generation right after this transcontinental disaster and the steamship disaster. Automobile, airplane. The Wright brothers with $2,000 of their own money make experiments with Kitty Hawk and invent the airplane. The funny thing was the Germans and the French were having government intervention to try to do it and flopping. And the Wright brothers, bicycle mechanics from Dayton, Ohio with no college education, see, you can't tell who's going to be your major league entrepreneur. You just turn the markets loose and see who rises. What we saw in that generation, 28 straight years after the Civil War, from 1865 to 1893, of budget surpluses, because we weren't spending money. We're going to get government reined in its proper function. Limited government. No more subsidies. We did have some protective tariffs here and there. Essentially a free market economy, freer perhaps than any other time in U.S. history. Our national debt went from $3 billion to $1 billion. Two-thirds of our national debt went off in the late 1800s. We started the period with an income tax and then abolished it. We raise money either through tariffs or through selling land and still had enough. Now, I know some of you think, well, what about government services? What about a safety net? The idea was people help people. Not government help people and send checks. People help people in need. We had the invention of the Red Cross in 1881. And the Red Cross to help people who go through disasters or communities, towns. Entrepreneurs came to the rescue of many great. Andrew Carnegie, who was the second wealthiest man in the United States in the steel industry, he was an immigrant to this country, and he said, what helped me was going to the library and reading books. Because I couldn't afford to go to college or go to much school, and so I just read books in the library. And he said, I want to help start libraries. He helped build over 2,500 libraries, some of which are in D.C. I saw the one at Howard University recently. Some of these are tremendous libraries that were built all around the country. He said, so people like me who don't have much, if they can't afford to go to school very far, they can at least read. And so free of charge in the library. So we have that. We have colleges, I mean like Vanderbilt University. See, the idea is the entrepreneurs say, let's meet human needs ourselves, not have the state set up a university. Privately, let's set up a university. Alexander Bell, Graham Bell started Gallaudet for deaf people. See, you say, well, what about people with special needs? Well, they're cared for here too. There are people trying to help them. Blacks, John D. Rockefeller, the first billionaire in U.S. history, he was able to sell oil so cheaply that people, it was mainly used for kerosene in the 1800s, for lighting, for light, not for gas so much. And he was able to help people light their homes for 1 cent an hour. The price went from $1 a gallon when he was early days starting to 8 cents a gallon under his leadership. And so he ended up giving, he was the first billionaire in U.S. history in the late 1800s he was around. Vanderbilt was the first American to be worth $100 million, and Rockefeller was the first American to be worth $1 billion. And both of those two did it by inventing and marketing products that millions of people wanted. Vanderbilt later went into railroads after his steamships. And so what you had with Rockefeller, he said, I'm going to give half of my money away. He did, which was funny because he was the first billionaire, and the guy who was in second place, Carnegie, had about $300 million. And Rockefeller gave away $500 million. So Rockefeller gave away more than the guy who was in second place possessed. And among the other things, he did this to help fight disease. Some of it was the boll weevil in the South, or meningitis even. They had a Rockefeller medical clinics. What I like, too, he started universities himself. His wife was Laura Spelman. Rockefeller was a strong Christian. He said, the smartest thing I ever did was make Jesus my Lord, and the second smartest thing I ever did was make Laura Spelman my wife. And he started Spelman College in Atlanta for black women. And he supported Tuskegee, which was the black men's college. And he said, what we need to help black literacy and help black Americans catch up is to diminish the gap in literacy, because 90% of whites could read and write, and after the Civil War, you know, I think you understand this, it was less than 20% of blacks could read and write. And he wanted to see that gap narrow, because he thought the more black Americans can read and write, then they'll catch up, and then they'll be able to take their place as American citizens with full knowledge to be able to make wise choices. And so Rockefeller thought it would be good to help black education. So he started Spelman College. Other people did. Hillsdale grad, I go to teach Hillsdale College. We had Clinton Fisk, was one of our students, who came down and started Fisk College in Nashville. Hillsdale was the second college in the country to be integrated, black and white together. And so we were integrated before the Civil War. And one of our graduates, Clinton Fisk, started Fisk College in Nashville. And Samuel Meharry started Meharry Medical School for blacks in Nashville. My point is that you had charitable activities that were abounding in the late 1800s because people were not heavily taxed. And some entrepreneurs didn't give a nickel. But you have people like Rockefeller who give $500 million. That kind of offsets that. The point is that enough givers took place that you had a higher, an ever-increasing literacy rate, a diminishing poverty rate, increase in prosperity in the United States, and you see the rise of the United States to becoming a world power. That's a story I want to leave you with in the very month that most of you begin your college experience. How many are having an American history course in the fall? Good. I hope you're able to use some of this material and it helps out. Thank you. Good, thank you. Thank you. Good. Good. No, you're very kind. We have some time for questions. Let's go for it. Yeah. Why don't we start? We have two. Yeah, go ahead. Give your name and just give us your question, and I'll do my best to answer it.
Certainly, sir. Thank you very much for coming. My name is Caleb Slater. I'm a rising senior at Ithaca College in Tompkins County, New York. And the reason why I mentioned the county specifically is your story about Vanderbilt and Collins reminds me of something that happened just the week before I came here. The county was trying to ban ride sharing. They saw many of the same arguments that you brought today, which is why it just... I was having flashbacks.
Okay.
That it was going, you were going to lose jobs, that they weren't going to be able to compete, that all of these things that are happening, and I don't know if this ride-sharing ban is happening anywhere else in the country. I guess my question to you is, what is your thought on what governments on local and state levels are trying to do to pick winners when it comes to cabs and ride-sharing and all that form, sir?
Thank you. Yeah, what I've seen is that the attempts of the local government to pick winners and losers, if anything, is even worse than when the federal government is picking winners and losers. And often people who have good influence, like Collins. By the way, Collins, remember, on the steamships, he hired a lobbying firm in D.C. to help him every year. And people who have good local contacts are the ones that say, well, we need to start a particular business. Let's have this fellow do it. And it's somebody who's made major contributions to the political party in power. So generally speaking, local decision making, when it's targeted on let's pick winners and pick losers. Now, I'm not talking about bidding things out where you take the low bid. That's what makes sense, anonymous low bids. But I'm talking about, well, we're going to start a dial-a-ride and we're going to choose this fellow to head it up or this company to head it up. Usually there are political connections involved. And when market forces are at work, the local citizens get better service at lower cost.
Thank you very much.
Sure. Yeah, go ahead.
Hi there. My name is Saurabh Sharma from the University of Texas at Austin. And
okay.
I had a question rooted somewhat in abstraction for you. There's been an effort by the political academic left to phase out the way we have taught history for time immemorial, especially at the high school level, where they say, oh no, history is not composed of great men, women, people who did great things. It is systems and it is large groups of people. And there's been a concerted effort to kind of do away with so-called great man history. And I wanted to get your opinion on that, possibly the ideological roots and how that affects our understanding of history.
Right, I think it's terrible when you take away the great people, men and women, who have made the kinds of accomplishments that have substantially made a difference. The way the Greeks and the Romans taught history, you know, at Hillsdale we have required courses in Western heritage and all this. We look at the Greeks and Romans. They thought the best way to teach was to get young people younger than you, but you start them at 6, 7, 10 years old and teach them role models, and then you emulate the role model. Because often kids don't grasp ideas. You know, they say, like, you know, you shouldn't steal. Yeah, but I want my sister's Xbox or something. You know, so you get that. But if you teach them someone who can inspire, and George Washington, by the way, in the 1800s served that function here in the United States. So when you take away great men and women, we lose role models that can be extremely important in helping us shape our own lives and figure out what do we believe and why do we believe it. By the way, I lived in Texas for 5 years and was on the Texas Textbook Commission one time, and I realized how hard it is to make a dent in the way they do, but I had a little bit of success. Finally, when I got the textbook people aside and would do, it's interesting, your question, because I would say, instead of saying, this textbook's terrible, look at the way it treats this subject, it treats Collins as a hero. It says the transcontinentals were the greatest thing ever. And, you know, I think, wow, did I ever win my point? And they'd nod their heads and go adopt the textbook. And then I thought, wait a minute, let's do it this way. And so I'd say, hey, you know, instead of meeting, I said, I've got a story to tell you. I've got the story about Collins to tell you, or about the transcontinentals, you know. And I knew, of course, what the textbook was saying. And I'd give them the story. And then they, you know, you could see at first they were stern, they were getting all interested in the story. Then, you mean Hill did this all by himself? James J. Hill? He built this transcontinental? I said, right. And then we open the textbook and there's nothing on Hill, and they've got the transcontinentals needed subsidies in order to be effective. And they're sitting there, wait a minute, our textbook says that? He's busily taking notes. So the funny thing is that the model of using men and women, great men and women, to help teach is not only good for teaching me and all of us, it was good for teaching the people who are in charge of the textbooks. So, yeah.
Thank you very much.
Sure. Thank you. Go ahead.
Hi there. Thank you for coming in. My name is Nathaniel Lamb, and I'm from The Ohio State University.
Okay.
And kind of like what he was saying, where history is kind of being changed. In academia, there's this kind of attempt to overthrow capitalism.
Yes.
And when in high school, when I learned about this area, they referred to it as the Gilded Age.
Yes.
Meaning it looked really good from the outside, but it was actually wrought with social issues. And, you know, the people were suffering, blah, 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 blah. What would your response, what would be your response to these teachers that are teaching that capitalism is actually evil?
Yeah. Of course, people were suffering. I mean, I suffered just teaching the story of the transcontinentals was suffering. So there is suffering, but it's usually the taxpayers that are suffering. You know, a lot of people who are immigrants, you know, sometimes people say immigrants were very poor. But it's interesting that immigrants, we had record numbers of immigrants. There was a greater transformation of people coming over here in the 1800s than any other place at any other time. And they weren't coming here because they thought their conditions were going to be worse. Now, I'm not saying everyone did real well. Some didn't do so well. Some, like Carnegie, became multimillionaires. But it was opportunity, and sometimes the next generations down did real well. And I think that's what's important to teach. You are exactly right. Whether you're teaching it at Ohio State or other institutions, you often get this idea that capitalism has failed. But it's really the only economic system that brings people out of poverty and gives people, like an immigrant like Andrew Carnegie, a chance, rather than having the state pick, or local communities is our question, pick winners and losers. If you have a good idea and you can market your idea and you can improve American innovation, then you can be successful. So I think we just need to hang on to the facts. One of the reasons I wanted to teach this and give you some facts is because you're exactly right, that is being taught, whether Ohio State or other places, and I want to pass out the ammunition and vicariously sit back and enjoy thinking, watching the firepower go out at my fellow faculty members who are teaching that.
Thank you very much.
Sure, go ahead.
Okay. Hi, my name is Aparna Subramanian. I'm from Southern Methodist University in Dallas.
Oh, yes.
And I agree with the textbook part because I went to high school in Texas.
Yeah, okay, yeah. Yes.
And my question to you is, because you said they reduced the debt back in the late 1800s, do you think if we went back to a similar free market society, we could do it again?
Yes, we could. This debt is not, it's so severe, mm-hmm, that it's got to be, it's thousands of dollars every second in interest payment. Mm-hmm. And it's a passing it along to your generation. Mm-hmm. My generation has failed in that respect. Mm-hmm. I can remember when I was growing up, the national debt was $300 billion, mm-hmm, and the interest rate on that was $9 billion. And I can remember my economics professor in high school saying, no sweat, we can pay that interest rate off easily. Well, see, now when it's up to $20 trillion, the interest rate when you get up to 5% or close to it is $1 trillion a year. And so it's a huge interest rate. Yes, just as we did 28 straight years of budget surpluses once we went to free markets after the Civil War, we can do the same thing again. And in fact, in those periods, like under President Reagan, his last 2 years, when we really had the tax cuts in, were actually the years of the least bad deficits. So the historical record is, and in the 1920s, we had 10 straight budget surpluses and knocked another third of our debt off and had a lot of free markets. The freer the economy, usually the debt starts disappearing as well.
Thank you.
Sure. Yeah.
Good Good morning. My name is Grant Wolf. I serve as the chairman of at SMU. Grant. Good to see you again, sir.
Thank you. Good to see you again. You've got your work cut out. You both of you at SMU. Yeah, go ahead.
Yes, we're having lots of fun. But I wanted to ask you about how we can apply the principles you're talking about to modern-day innovators like Elon Musk and Tesla and things like that. Because obviously, in my understanding, they've received some government assistance and yet managed to be very innovative. Do you expect that other competitors might be able to enter the market or deliver more solutions if we applied the principles of free markets?
I think that's good to mention Elon Musk because he's someone receiving government subsidies. He appears to be innovative, but right now we see more subsidy reception than we do innovation. And that has tended to be the pattern. We're still early in that story, but I think the historical lessons apply. Most textbooks do not, they'll mention the transcontinentals, but often they don't give us the lesson of the steamships. And sometimes with our airplanes, by the way, we tried a subsidized airplane company that bombed before we got the Wright brothers in to do it free market. So the more we understand the historical results of subsidies, the better decisions that we're going to make. And I think it's likely that we can do better than what Elon Musk is doing, but it's still early.
Thank you.
Go ahead. Thank you. Thank you.
All right, guys, let's give it up for Dr. Folsom one more time. All right. Go ahead and take about a 5-minute break. We will be back in about 5 minutes.